Hi guys, and welcome to Insomnia True Silver Championship. I'm your host Nimsh, and I'm here with Noxious, Raven, and Lothar. And this is the first day. Well, this is actually the second day.
Right. Yeah, there was actually a first day yesterday, technically. It just wasn't broadcast in the way that today is. So.
That's right, that's right. Noxious, how are you doing, by the way? Like, you flew here from the United States.
Well, Canada specifically, but pretty much the same as the U.S. as far as, you know, the travel time. Yesterday I was so jet lagged, because basically when I landed, it was 6 a.m. here, and I had just gone through an entire day. So I slept. I don't think we saw each other yesterday. I was just sleeping.
Yeah,
I
was just sleeping. How many hours was that flight?
Like, I think it adds up to about 11. It's not
11
it's
hours.
Not that much, but let's
well,
just
I
say.
Had 10.
Yeah, actually, longer. Had even a longer flight.
Yeah, right. Well, you know, coming from Poland to UK takes a while, so.
Right, it does. Yeah.
What happened there, Lothar?
The first plane was delayed, so I didn't catch the connecting flight. So I just had to casually wait 4.5 hours on the next one.
Good.
But yeah, but I'm here and I'm excited. The first day of qualifier had given us 6 players to advance the second day today. So we have the full top 16 who won the qualifier from the UK one and the international one. So I'm pretty much really hyped.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. And Raven, you're the local. Your travel time wasn't that bad, right?
2-hour drive from Manchester, so not too bad for me. I'm sorry, guys. but yeah, for once, like,
perfect.
It's local, so it's okay for me.
All right, good. So, Noxious, what is the tournament format, though?
Well, so basically, that was super smooth. Basically...
I'm so glad you asked.
Right.
You know, we are having a tournament here.
That's, I know. I absolutely
super good
know.
Transition.
Basically, the tournament format is last hero standing, best of 5, and it's going to be no ban. So basically, the players are going to be playing in group stage. So it's going to be group A, B, C, D in round robin. And the fact that it's last hero standing, I'm actually pretty happy about because it means that overall Blizzard is recognizing last hero standing, and we're seeing a lot of tournaments right now bringing back the format as a whole.
Yeah, absolutely. We've seen it at DreamHack Winter as well, and the format was pretty cool. Do you guys like last hero standing as well?
I just think it's awesome that we don't have one format that is like basically forced on every single event. Because we all know that this just give us a way to be kind of bored with the tournament with the tournaments to watch, and it makes it more interesting for the viewers and for the players just to see different kind of meta games. Because if there will be last hero standing, it's way different from Conquest. Then we have Conquest, which might have also include ban, and it's also different. Then we have last hero standing with a ban, and it's also different. It all changes and switches around. So it's really cool to see something else, and that the organizers have the freedom of doing something that they want if they have an interesting idea.
Yeah, so, and I agree. I think, like, especially next year, because I think Blizzard have actually said we're going to be running multiple different formats. And, you know, like the fact that, like Lothar said, if they're accepting that already and saying it's not just going to be one stuck format for the whole year, that's going to be really good, just to see some differences.
Yep, exactly.
Yep, absolutely. And we have 16 players for today. We'll be having 4 groups and players playing in a round robin format. So everyone versus everyone in the group stage. And
first time I hear of that player, everyone.
Everyone versus.
We've seen Raven versus Raven during the rehearsals.
I won.
Yeah, you did win. Congratulations on that. That's why you're joining us on the couch right now as the winner.
Was that the prize? Or was that because I lost? I'm not sure.
It's because you're a good caster.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
Yeah, so, that's what it is. Group stages, guys.
Yeah, basically the way it worked is we have 8 invites and 8 qualifiers. We had multiple qualifiers, actually. There were 2 online. One was the international one, so anybody could qualify, and one that was specific to the UK. So in a nutshell, that means that we are guaranteed a UK player. I believe we had the LAN qualifier yesterday, which gave us other players as well in the format. So we're going to see names that we maybe don't expect to see. However, we do have names that we recognize, right? There's Legendarian, we have Super JJ, we've also got Freaky that showed up. So we've got 3 players that we know that qualified through the Open, which basically means that they got their through their own merits, of course, and a bunch of players that are mostly unknown, although we did see some of them play online that was broadcast.
Absolutely. But the UK qualifier was really interesting because they played it was an online qualifier, but they played the finals here,
right, just
next to us. So we actually have a video for you guys showing exactly what happened with those 2 guys playing the qualifier.
My Richard!
Earlier today, we had the final of the UK qualifier for the True Silver Championship. It was Sottle versus Visual. We headed down to the Game Galleon to see who would take their spot in the finals.
I
Well, the match was finally balanced in the first two games, with the Face Hunter beating the Paladin and the Priest being the Face Hunter. No surprises yet, but game three was going to be crucial for the series. Renal Lock versus Priest. Set in the final as one of the UK's top pros, Sottle, lost to a relative unknown Visual. He'll now take a spot in the 16-man main event tomorrow, while Sottle will have another chance in our BYOC qualifier.
I'm absolutely rapt with this win. I never expected to get this far into the tournament. You know, obviously I know how to play and I know what I'm doing, but I'm up against professionals and I'm just, you know, play it casually. Still shaking.
Obviously I'm disappointed. It's like, it's a heartbreaking way to go. Looking forward now to just playing some more Hearthstone, just trying to get through. Great field of players here, but hopefully if I play my best, I can still qualify for top 16.
When I saw the Reno, it took about a second for it to actually sink in, and then I just had a pause. I just had a bit of a laugh to myself. Took my time, life-tapped, played Reno, and just, I got a reaction from Sottle, and that was great. Like, I knew at that point I'd won the tournament.
All right, guys, and we have Visual qualifying for the top 16, and that was a pretty cool win.
Yeah, I mean,
on the back of Reno, Jackson.
Yeah, Reno, right? Straight off the top, why not, eh?
I still remember the first time it happened with Super JJ and the Freeze Mage.
We were casting that one.
Right, I was casting it. It was like the first appearance in tournament of Reno. It was like from 1 health to 30, and it's funny enough because I have expected the card to be more of a novelty. I was like, yeah, maybe that'll work, but for the most part, maybe people won't be bringing it to events, but as it turns out, it's competitive.
Absolutely.
It's highly competitive.
It's a great card, and yeah. It's a lot of face hunters really hate it at the moment.
Well, we have seen a small, withdrawal,
a big
of
decrease, yeah.
Face hunters, and they switched to more consistent versions with Savannah High Mains, and with just more stable way of dealing damage than just pulling out those small minions that can be easily removed. But you can't rely on your hero power anymore because there's a single card that just shuts you down.
Yeah,
and so people need just big minions to swing that damage like a truck.
And that was just the first explorer, because we also have Bram Bronzebeard, Sir Murgleton, yeah. And now Elise Starseeker. So I really hope, because this is the first tournament where people can play Elise Starseeker.
I want to see some of that.
Go
I want to see some Nat Pagels and
Norwalker
Chos. That's what I'm hoping for.
Well, I'm kind of skeptic when it comes to Golden Monkey, but I think some people should bring Durafam, the 9 mana drop.
Right.
I think it's actually viable
yeah.
for competitive yeah. gaming. It might be not top tier, but I think for some decks, to midrange decks, an example, it's bringing a lot of value. It's a win condition on its own. You don't need anything else. It's just like, let's say, you played the Scenarios in midrange Druid, right? It's also 9 mana, and it's kind of a win condition, helps with Savage Roar.
Sure.
But Rafam is basically the same, but it gives you the win condition on its own.
Yeah, if you have a shade stealth, right. You might take +10/+10,
yeah.
You might take all the 2/3s basically.
Yeah, it's the fact that you can pick which one's relevant at that moment
right,
in the game
exactly.
to actually push through for the win. So I think it's going to be really good.
Raven is a specialist on Ravens. How do you evaluate the Raven Idol?
Unfortunately, I don't think it's very good. Actually,
what?
What? Oh, do you disagree?
No, it's fine. Just keep going.
It's so sad.
I'm
to
curious
hear,
to hear the.
Yeah, I don't. I just think I would rather. I wish there was a better card called Raven something or other. But yeah, I just think instead of discovering a random card that you might be useful at a specific situation, I would always just rather have the card that I want in my deck consistently instead.
Yeah, I think the fact that you can discover spells and it guarantees that it's going to be a Druid ramp. Of course. I think that gives it a bit of viability. But then again, you know, I still haven't seen it played remotely enough to make a call.
Do you want to have 3 inner fates in your deck?
I want 5. But okay, maybe not a stop decks. But I'll take those.
Yeah, you don't want to have too many of them. Yesterday, as mentioned before, we also had this qualifier, and Super JJ Freaky Legendarian went through. We also had 3 UK guys going through Board Control, and who was there also?
There was Ness and
Board Control, Ness and Riri.
And Riri,
oh,
and
Ness
exactly.
And Riri, yeah, absolutely. And we have Slytha winning the online qualifier. He is from Spain. So a lot of great things happen, and I think we actually have a video for you guys prepared also with those people explaining the qualifier yesterday.
The Silver Championship here at Insomnia 56 is the largest Hearthstone event that's ever happened in the UK. $30,000 are on the line, players have come from around the world, and reputations are at stake. The level of competition is fierce. Hundreds of players have tried to qualify for this event, alongside the 8 invited players who are some of the best in the world, including 3 players who entered the World Championships and a host of players who've won major tournaments.
Here for the first time at the Insomnia is really cool. I never expected that there is such a big event in England, but this is really impressive. Like, the amount of people that are gathered here to play computer games is really awesome, and I really like the event. Play my best, and hopefully I will be the one that advances.
My chances to win the whole tournament are good. I mean, I'm not worse than anyone here, but it's a difficult tournament.
The competition, really, really, really intense. They're all playing really good decks, which you kind of expect. It's an amazing experience, really. I've never been to a big tournament like this. Really good fun all the way through.
Qualifier here at the True Silver Championship is now over. We know the 6 players who are advancing to the top 16 and the group stage tomorrow. They'll test themselves against some of the best players in the world, while the players who didn't make it will watch on and wonder what might have been.
All right, guys, we had a lot of fun yesterday, and we have a lot of fun today planned for every viewer. But Insomnia and RDU was telling people that he wasn't aware that there is such a big event in UK. Raven, this is Insomnia 56. What happened in the latest 55 Insomnias before?
Okay, so I've not been going to Insomnia that long, unfortunately, but I've been from Insomnia 49, so I started there a couple of years ago now. It's just a great event for the UK. The fact that we have a big LAN event that runs tournaments across multiple games, it's not just Hearthstone that's here, it's actually all the popular esports games, and it's consistently well run. Everything always goes pretty well. The venue's fantastic. It's great for the UK scene overall.
It really seems like a small dream hack. When you first enter, there's a lot of people just with their PCs
right,
set up.
Yeah. Eating stuff, drinking energy drinks. Yeah, it's full dream hack.
Absolutely, for gamers.
I'm sure that during Insomnia 1, the first one, I'm sure they were still playing Quake 1 without mouses, just on keyboards.
In keyboards, yeah.
I remember those times. It was so awesome
old
times.
Oh, man, you're old.
I saw a guy yesterday who actually came here over 1 day prior. You could actually come in to set up your PC. And he was already, awake 24 hours when the event started. I'll have to check up on him because I don't think he'll make
sure
it through the weekend.
Okay.
It is insomnia, man. Like,
right.
we don't sleep. Game all
That's
the time.
What you do. Yeah,
and you can see the setup behind us a bit. Like, people with computers playing all those games. So it's pretty exciting, guys. Pretty exciting.
There's
and
a lot of people.
Yeah.
And this is the first time we're actually going global with Insomnia and presenting it to all the viewers. I mean, you probably could have seen Insomnia before, but it was UK only mostly.
Yeah, now that it's opened up, especially, like bringing in invites from some of the best players around the world, really, it's really huge, especially for Hearthstone doing this. So this is going to be a big tournament, and hopefully we'll see more of this in the future.
Yeah.
Hoping so.
And it's a big step for those UK players who qualified as well, because this is their chance as local guys to get known globally and playing versus people like Life Coach, like Dice, RDU. Yeah.
It's not only that, but the tournament itself has a really huge prize pool. It's nothing to scoff on. It's $30,000. The first place gets like 10,000. Right?
Yeah, 10,000 first place, 5,000 second place. But for those guys, it might be important that actually top 16 is getting money as well, because if you're in top 16, you're already in the money.
625.
Yeah. That's something. That's
something, man.
Especially if you're just local and you just came here.
Yeah, it's more than some people have made in their careers in esports.
Yeah, that's
in
true.
In some cases. So.
How much Frodan did, Aaron?
I actually did not know.
He got a Ferrari though.
Oh yeah, I think he'll be just fine.
Yeah, but it was like a small one, so .
Yeah, that's.
It's the first step.
I'm interested though, like Raven, for a UK person and a gamer, how important Insomnia is?
It's really important, especially now. I mean, in general, there's just not a lot in the UK. The esports scene's very small compared to some other countries like Germany, Sweden, the obvious ones in Europe. But for the UK, it's just like I said, it's great. And the fact that it's growing every single time there's an event, it gets bigger, it gets better. The tournaments have become bigger, bigger prize pools. So yeah, it's just super important for the players to get exposure.
Yeah. All right. They're also starting to, Battleborn's first tournament, I think, is happening here as well, which is a really big first step. Considering the game is kind of awaited by a lot of players. So the event itself is pretty huge.
Yeah, they announced they are expanding to Scotland and Ireland, I believe, as well.
Yeah, that's going to be next year, I believe, yeah.
Yeah.
Sweet.
So more Insomnias for us and more Insomnias for you guys. And we are almost ready with the first match. The first match is going to be AK Wonder versus RDU. And we've seen RDU already talking about Insomnia. Lothar, what can you tell us about RDU?
RDU is a very young and talented player who likes to analyze the games and talk about it a lot.
Yeah.
I would summarize him like in those few words. You know, he's after a game, he has an essay written already.
And, every game, not every match, every game, literally. Yeah.
I mean, it's something really unique because what I like and what I would love to see him do more is an actual report on tournaments. He had a really good job of doing it after ATLC. He wrote also another piece recently on our site on g2esports.com and
subtle,
right? Yeah, and he's really doing a great job at that. And that's what I miss the most from the TCG times we played.
Articles. Games,
right? Yeah, the written reports.
Yeah, those were really sweet to read.
Right.
Like you just went, there was like a, let's say, a major tournament in whatever card game you played. And there were so many reports just to read what people played, what people, how people prepared, what was the top 8, what are the deck lists and stuff. So, yeah.
All right. And AK Wonder from Spain, one of the best Spanish players at the moment, playing for SK. And I think they faced each other before. Noxious, before you leave us, because Noxious will be leaving
right.
us for the first match. Any last words about this matchup? What would you like to see?
At least Starseeker and Druid from RDU. That's what I'm hoping. It's not happening, but I'm hoping.
But we can always dream, right?
Yeah. It's semi-decent in mid-range, but unfortunately, maybe not.
All right, fingers crossed. Thank you so much, Noxious, then, and see you for the next match.
Yep, be back.
All right, guys, now we have the Mulligans. We didn't talk about the lineups that much, but both players brought Warlock. There is Paladin as well, and the only difference is Druid versus Warrior.
Well, we have two Warlocks lining up for the first game, and it looks like RDU, RDU is bringing a Zoo, ordinary Zoo, at least for now, and then we have a...
Sure.
Will it be a Reno Jackson Warlock? It's really difficult to say, like from the just opening
sure,
hand,
no problem.
When you can see Brand Bronze and Dark Petal, because both of those cards can be played in Malaga's Warlock and Reno Jackson Warlock at the same time. And we have seen even versions of Reno Warlock with two Molten Giants.
Yeah, there's always a chance. And what do you think about the earlier versions? I'm not seeing people play it too often, but the double Molten Giant for me is always scary. Because if you don't draw them, Reno's pointless.
That's true, but then if you draw two Molten Giants and don't draw Reno Jackson, then it's way better.
Yeah, that's very true. So we do see Bran. There's still nothing too much to give away there. But what do you think about RDU's start, actually? He's got a pretty decent start. He has the Creeper into Egg. And even a Power Overwhelming in hand to be able to buff the Egg and proc it for a trade.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys. Just had a couple of technical issues then. But we do see RDU's going to drop the Creeper down. And this is looking more and more like, would you say this is Reno Lock, Lothar? It's just drawn into the Farseer. Again, it's still a bit difficult. There are some handlocks that still play that. Oh, Sir Finley.
Well,
you don't want to take that as pretty much any Warlock deck, right?
That's one of the cards that you can't really take when you're playing that kind of Warlock, as you rely so much on just drawing cards. You can't really change your hero power. And I think the Farseer actually gives it out that this might be just Malaga's Warlock, but the inclusion of Molten Giants is so weird.
Yeah, it's really tough. I mean, that's the thing with especially a lot of decks at the moment. There's so much variation in the game. with the League of Explorers adding so many different deck archetypes. So it's a real tough one. I mean, what do you even want to pick at this point in the game? He does go for Finley. What's the game plan here, though? Because surely most Warlock decks, the whole point of the thing is that everyone thinks that the Warlock hero power is the best in the game because it allows you to cycle through your deck quicker.
I actually pick Warlock's hero power a lot for Shaman, sometimes even Hunters, because if you want to have more consistent threats, you can just happen to get more cards.
Yeah, you can just draw on demand. So that's always nice. So the Peddler is going to challenge the Creep a little bit, but the Egg going down seems really okay with the Direwolf Alpha in hand as well. He can even buff and kill off the Peddler next turn if he really needs to.
That's true, but look at that. AK Wonder did draw a Silence right now, and I think this is the best moment to cast it.
Yep.
It's just, when you think about it, you just deal 4 damage to a minion, and you don't need to exchange any damage, and so there's
and
no
also
loss.
One of the issues is just silencing it and not being able to kill the Egg still isn't perfect because it's still a body that can be buffed, and what you know obviously Zoo runs Power Overwhelming and the Direwolves that we can see to give the extra damage there, so killing it off's really good. It's whether
and Void Terrors too.
Yeah, very true. Do you even play Finley now? I am super confused about the Finley pick.
I have no idea why he did pick the Finley. He's not even playing it right now, and I think it's I will have to ask him, you know, because I'm
we're going to have to ask him already. There's a query in the game.
It's so weird to pick the Finley right now when you can't really play it at any given point of the game because you have the Molten Giant in the hand.
Yeah.
You need to be tapping, especially against Zoo, because Zoo is not that explosive. So if you want to bring yourself down to like around 12 HP, I guess you would have to tap at least 2-3 times.
Yeah.
And that leaves the Finley completely obsolete late game.
And that's one of the win conditions, isn't it? For this matchup, you get the big taunts down, and Zoo has a problem dealing with them and punching through anything like a taunted Molten Giant without. If they're using Power Overwhelmings to punch through those, and they're not using them to actually kill you, so that's definitely one of the ways you can win.
Yeah.
And now he has Molten Giant into Healbot potentially later on, which is a really good light turn if you can get the Molten Giant for free and then heal back up with 8 more health and even Brand. So it's looking like although Wonder picked the Finley and we're not quite sure what his game plan is long term with that, he does have some good combos in hand to be able to deal with the aggressive Zoo deck here.
Mm-hmm. And now he also uses the Farseer to heal up his Dark Peddler. That means he pushes RDU from his perspective. He pushes RDU to use the M Gang boss to kill the Dark Peddler. But we know that RDU has the Direwolf Alpha. It can have a perfect trade here, and even tap if he doesn't want to play the Haunted Creeper. But with the Doomguard in hand, I would say you would like to empty your hand as soon as possible.
Yeah, you don't want to fill your hand up because you can't reliably know you're going to draw into Void Callers quick enough.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I like that as well, and especially with the Direwolf Alpha buffing like the Creeper and then the tokens that it's going to proc, it's a pretty good play there. And Wonder's gone into it's tapped into a Zombie Child, something he's probably looking for a little bit early in the game.
Yeah, of course, like Zombie Child is the best one drop minion in the game, unless you're playing a Secret Paladin and you have a Secret Keeper in your opening hand. Because that's like even better than the Zombie Chow. But for RDU to win this game, what he has to plan is just to burst down AK from the point when he is not able to play the Molten Giants. But at the same time, from the cards that he has seen right now, he can't really read that there might be a Molten Giant even in his opponent's hand. So my assumption here will be that RDU will just deal damage and not care about possible Molten Giants because he will not anticipate one.
And especially seeing Bran, like this is something that's super common in Malygos Warlock. So far, and the positive thing about when you play against Malygos Warlock as an aggressive deck, it can be a rough matchup, but you presume the Molten Giants aren't there, so you just go hyper-aggressive and try and kill them quickly. But also for AK Wonder, playing Bran on just dropping him always feels terrible. His effect can be so powerful with cards like Healbot that it's kind of rough to just drop it as a 2-4 and like hope it's enough to slow down.
It is rough, but at the same time, he doesn't even have that hand that will benefit
having Bran. Yeah.
So he just goes for the survival mode. He just needs the cards that will just soak some damage in the early game and allow him to build up to the late game himself. Juan Ledrick also too late. Turn 4 was perfect for that car, but I feel like he's being pushed to use Tap and Juan Ledrick in this situation, or just thinly zombie shout Juan Ledrick to play as many minions as possible so he can maybe have something on board for the next turn, Shadow Flame. Yep. I think so difficult to make a decision.
Yeah,
here.
I think at this point, because he's seeming quite far behind without any easy AoE options to clear the board, playing Finley might actually work out okay, because he might not get to the point where he needs to tap into Molten. He'll actually just, his opponent's being aggressive enough that he can just get away with just playing the Molten later on due to the opponent's damage. So I don't mind just dropping as much on the board as possible at this point. It's gonna go. Hellfire. Okay.
Will it change this game here?
Do you want to hold off one more turn for the Hellfire and try and get like the trades out? If you choose, I mean, you probably won't trade with the Drake though. So the only thing you're gonna do is kill the Voidwalker, which isn't gonna do too much. So maybe your Hellfire now.
I would say you should probably Hellfire now, because you will damage your own Twilight Drake unless you plan to play the Shadow Flame. And Shadow Flame will kill the whole board, including Mimgame boss. So maybe it's better to just plan a Shadow Flame, because you anticipate there will be no trades from RDU, right? With the Soladric, unless there will be a really good PO target for that.
Yeah. The real frustration here for Wonder is that Voidwalker. It's blocking the like the better attacks into the minions, like the Creeper, that are going to sort of survive the AoE with the Death Rattles, or even the Imp Gang boss leaving a 1-1 up. Mm-hmm. So he has to sort of attack in, or just Shadow Flame, like you said, and either way, this is going to still leave some tokens on the board. Oh, is he going to just kill it?
Yeah, and he's playing around Shadow Flame.
Oh, fair enough. He can just follow. You just slam Doomguard, right?
Well, I think he does.
Not too upset about losing the dog.
And this means that IK Wonder will be able to play the Molten Giant for zero mana and pair it up with a Shadow Flame if he needs that.
Is there anything else he can do? Because the problem is, even though if he Molten Giant and Antique Healbot, then he's just taking he's taking the damage he heals for plus extra, and you never know what your opponent's going to tap into. Although he's got no cards.
And Doomguard.
Yeah, although the Zulok's got no cards, he can just freely life tap. He's on 30 health, so he's not actually life tap once yet, so he can just draw two cards next turn, and the likelihood of Zoo having some kind of extra burst in two cards is pretty likely.
So from RDO's perspective, it's looking pretty damn good, but the Molten Giant will change something here. And I think the Shadow Flame has to be played. Yeah. Even though it leaves three minions on board, I think you have to just kill that Doomguard instantly. You have no minions to taunt it up. So you just have to follow it up with the Finley into maybe a armor up or increase your power.
Here we go. What are the options?
That was the heal.
Yep. Yeah, snap pick on the heal there. Don't blame him at all. And Shadow Flame, like you said, is going to clear up. There's a couple of tokens left, but the Finley and the Zombie Chow kind of deal with those. Oh, is he not going to play the Chow? He values the heal.
Well, that's really weird. Because I would say that if he wants to make a comeback as soon as possible, because the Hellfire seems to... Oh my god, what I just said!
So he didn't even need to tap for it. So now he can play Doomguard and tap into an extra card without having to throw it away, so...
Yeah, but there's Siphon Soul waiting for that Doomguard, so... AK Wonder will be able to heal up to 8 and kill one of the minions, and that means he can actually
stabilize. Slow comeback now?
Yeah, he can actually stabilize now. The Finley proves to be useful, very useful right now.
It just felt kind of weird picking it that early, when like literally the start of the game, you're like, okay, I'll pick Finley.
And he didn't
when he had Soulfire as well.
Well, he didn't have he didn't have fire. He didn't have the Shadow Flame at that point, so it was really weird to pick it up. But
double Argus to draw into
really
now the Voidwalker.
I mean, Argus can tap every single turn, drop two threats per turn, and deal a lot of damage. I really like if he will be trading here, because he doesn't want to give any options for AK Wonder to buff the minion, to play another Shadow Flame. He's not certain what kind of deck AK Wonder is sporting, so I really like that.
Yeah, this is going to be a nice hell. Oh,
Yugen!
Okay, so it's going to be a nice Hellfire into a Healbot, I imagine, this turn. So he's going to clear the board up, leave a 3-3 on the board. Not too bad versus Zoo, actually. Like 3-3 can actually deal with a lot of the minions they put down. Obviously, not some of the bombs, like if there's a Dr. Boom or even a Mal'Ganis or anything like that in the deck.
PO drone, not really not really that helpful.
Yeah, and even the Argus doesn't do too much.
He
here,
just
so
needed
a,
he just needed two minions, basically.
Yeah.
But that's what he needed.
And suddenly implosion, and is that Vugen, right? Yeah. This is looking rough, because next turn he can follow up with Argus on the Fugan, and what's that? Are you going to do? With two Doomguards gone as well, how is he actually going to push through this damage?
There's not much you can do.
So, what side are you going to draw into? The Abusive doesn't do much here, the Life Tap into his own Implosion, actually, but again...
Well,
no,
he has
no,
to use it.
Yeah, no real way to deal with this Fugan, though. And he's only on 13 health now.
Well, there's a Zombie Chow. We can kill the Zombie Chow and get it back to 18. But at the same time, it's it's a really tough spot for RDU.
And we've not
and even hits two.
Not even seen Reno yet. Oh, and there we go. Okay.
All right.
First
so
game
AK
goes
Wonder.
To AK Wonder.
Yeah, AK Wonder wins the first game. I'm back, by the way, guys. That was a pretty interesting game overall, I think, with this comeback. Finley healing and... And even though there was a Doomguard top deck, Siphon Soul dealt with that pretty easy.
Siphon Soul shut it down. Imagine the game before the Siphon Soul opened. Oh, well, if the Doomguard was even less probable than the Siphon Soul, right? But it was a back and forth, and the Finley made a difference. So kudos to AK Wonder for picking it up. But at the same time, I think it was a very questionable decision to take the Finley in the beginning of the game, where just a slight more damage from RDUs in the beginning of them would mean end of it.
Yeah, already. Soulfire was an option.
Yeah, well,
so he could have done that. But also the playing the Reno deck and drawing into the two AoE in the form of Hellfire and Shadow Flame relatively early without too many life taps as well. Like, that was pretty big impact to be able to clear the board.
You didn't get Reno though, and there was always a chance of just getting that Reno and slamming it to kill yourself to full. So this means that RDU can't use his Zoo anymore. His Zoo got killed, and AK Wonder will have to continue with the Reno Lock. So we are going to see another game with the Reno Lock, because this is last hero standing. This is not Conquest.
And now RDU knows what he's up against as well, so probably alter playstyle to not be too all-in, because if you overcommit and that Reno comes down, then it's going to be an issue. But is this Paladin with a Leper Gnome?
Well, that means RDU is bringing some really aggressive decks. And well, it should probably work. I guess it's even better to play aggressive decks against those type of Reno Jackson Warlocks, which can bring some odd value to the table, like the Fugan Starlight combo might shut down any control decks with the almost impossible to deal with 11-11 body unless you have a big game hunter. But that's like the only answer.
And you do run out of big game hunters at some point, especially if there are molten giants.
And the real issue is if you play both of the minions on the board at the same time and they die, it summons two 11-11s. So that's twice as difficult to deal with.
Yeah, that's right. So with the Leper Gnome, it seems like RDU is playing kind of like a face paladin with Divine Favor.
It might be the case. We'll see what it goes. But a Zombie Chow Mulligan for AK Wonder will make a huge difference, especially that he is first in this game. So Zombie Chow for AK Wonder probably make RDU switch his strategy for the opening, and we'll probably see a turn two Masterful Battle instead of H mini bot. So I guess this might mean the Sinon will be Leper Gnome as predicted. But then turn two will be Masterful Battle to kill out the Zombie Chow.
Yeah, to be able to use the weapon to kill off the Chow.
And that basically will allow RDU to take some advantage from the early game.
Yeah, unless there is something... Oh, Twisting Nether.
Nice.
I like this deck. This deck can bring a lot of good cards to the table.
Yeah, and even on the AK Wonder side, the Farsi is going to be really nice just to drop down. If he's just seen the Leper Gnome, so already he knows something's a little bit off with this Paladin deck. It's not a standard pick in, say, Secret Paladin. So maybe he's going to just play up the Farseer and then have Shadow Flame available if he really feels like he's under pressure. But at the moment, he's doing pretty well. That Zombie Chow, as you said, Lothar, turn one, pretty important in the aggro matchups.
And that's his plan, basically. Just stop the aggression early, and even if he takes the damage, he has so much heal available in form of that Farseer, heal bots with Bran, Reno, Jackson, and Siphon Soul as well.
Well, the fact that he had the Zombie Chow added did add about 4 HP points to his life total, so yeah. It was a really huge deal.
Yeah, and every turn that goes by is a turn closer to drawing Reno, right?
So, yeah.
And as soon as Reno comes down against an aggro deck, it's going to be very difficult for him to claw the way back.
And now, Artie, you can't really play on curve. He had 3 mana. Goes for the Shield Amoeba, which is the best minion. And he got that Shredder for turn 4, which is pretty good as well. Shredder into Lothab. Round Bronzebeard.
There's a possibility to just clear the entire board right now, yeah, but I guess Implosion is much better, especially if you get more than 2 on the minibot. I assume that AK-1 will attack into the minibot and then Implosion it. Yeah. Otherwise, he's being left with the brand, and I don't think he wants to play it right now.
No, I think the either the Shadow Flame option or the Implosion option are good enough to not just play Bran onto the board. Be interesting to go, which, so you prefer the Implosion here, Lothar?
I would say that I prefer the Implosion, because...
It would just be scary going to turn 4 versus Paladin, because they probably, even an aggro Paladin probably still runs Consecrate, right?
Yeah, well, okay, that's a good point. But at the same time, you make your opponent play Consecration instead of anything else.
Ooh.
Well, that makes a huge difference.
That's a nice collection. With Bran, Bronzebeard, Rinya, Jackson, 2 Explorers already. It's so cool that he won with Finley like last game.
This is an interesting situation because RDU doesn't want to trade at all with this deck. But this is a good trade.
Yeah, offering such a good target.
Yeah.
Also, the problem is when you see one of these guys come down, you do kill it, but then you're so worried about the next one because, again, you can't, even though the next one's, say, the less threatening in terms of damage, as it's a 4-7, you can't really just leave it up a lot of the time unless he's so far ahead that it doesn't matter. But if you do kill it, like we said earlier, the 11-11's coming out to play, so...
Was there a chance to not to kill it? Because you've seen Shadow Flame, and if AK Wonder goes to phase for 7, do you really care?
But AK Wonder will trade with this minion.
Yeah, but then you do have the Juggles. But maybe the fact that actually the Juggles do not go to phase, but they can go into the minion. And he had 2 Juggles this turn. 3 Juggles, actually. Alright, so it makes a lot of sense to actually kill it.
Well, that will make a huge difference.
Is Implosion a thing now?
Yeah.
You have to Implosion the Juggler.
The problem is that there are 2 minions that are great at dealing with those 1-1 minions, so...
Oh. It makes sense, the Implosion to Juggler.
You just need to get it off the board this turn or it's going to snowball, I think. But the Twilight Drake's a reasonable pickup. You can maybe do something with it next turn. He is only on 19 health, so he's getting a little bit pressured, and we see Adiyu's actually playing...
Jackson already!
Oh, yeah, I mean, that's fine. And you see, yeah, Adiyu's playing Blessed of Might, so yeah, a bit of a new style. We've not really seen in a pure aggressive Paladin in quite a while, actually.
Is Reno active, though? Like, what are normally the doubles?
It must be. If he's running Twisting Nether in the deck, Reno must be active, right?
The only possibility is the double Molten Giant, but I would assume that he is not risking that much. There was a case with, I think it was Surrender's deck, first iteration.
The double Molten.
Double Molten, but it was not that popular after a few days of playing.
Yeah. And everything else is a one-off.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I think you just, if you're going to play a Reno deck like this, because you've got to sort of battle with the one-off issue and just the slightly unreliable nature of the deck, you need to at least have Reno guaranteed. So when you do draw into it, you guarantee that like back up to 30 health.
But look at the situation. There's 11, 12, 13 damage on board right now.
You probably have to Bran.
And if you play Bran and Defender of Argus, you will have 4-6 minion on board with Taunt. But at the same time, if there's a single silence, you'll probably be dead. So I wouldn't be surprised if he just goes for the Reno Jackson right now.
And next turn, he can twist in there as well.
If Reno is active, absolutely. Just go for it. That's 60 heal.
Yep, so this does also signify that there's no double Molten in the deck. It is just one-offs. And but even so, just seeing Reno now, the only thing you're really worried about are the heal bots. Is there an option to just ignore Reno and just go all face? Or do you really want to trade? Oh, it's
a 6-1.
Okay, yeah. I just saw it was actually 6 attack. I thought it was 5. I take it all back. You definitely kill Reno.
It was absolutely perfect. But on the other hand, RDU is out of cards. He doesn't have any cards. There is the Twisting Nether. It's... has a great animation, and a lot of players don't even know how it looks like.
It looks amazing, definitely. So in this style of deck from RDU, you've got to imagine he's running at least one Divine Favor. Because in the old versions of Aggro Paladin, you just had to run them out because there's no other card drawing in the deck.
That has to be two divine favors, I would even say.
It wouldn't surprise me if there was two, yeah.
For RDU, of course, it would be the best draw, but Maximo Battle wasn't that bad. I mean, he just filled the board after Twisting Nether, after Shadow Flames.
There's only Hellfire left.
Yes.
I think people either play Demon Wrath or Twisting Nether. Be surprised if people play both.
He's going for Bran. I would probably like to see just Twilight Drake and Defender. Like, even Dr. Boom is fine here, because...
You expecting, what would it be, 9-10 damage burst from the Paladin?
Yeah, I would not expect that much burst.
Yeah, even an aggressive Paladin, they need like double... He doesn't have any cards, so like one card burst isn't going to happen.
But this is a nice setup for Defender of Argus, Siphon Stall for next turn, if RDU picks something big. So he wants to have a lot of taunts, and RDU is actually going to kill an owl here.
Also, K-Wonder wanted to remove cards from his hand as soon as possible just to play around Divine Favor as little as he can, but it's always something.
And realistically, Divine Favor's probably one of the only things he's going to lose to, but there's Molten Giant for one into Argus with Bran, so... I don't think RDU can punch through that much damage.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he's waiting, actually.
AK-Wonder's
obviously just stacking up. Oh, okay, he's playing in that order to get the BGH down. Okay.
Wow, and the Defender of Argus with the double effect.
A casual 6-13.
It's a 6-13 minion.
It's suddenly aggressive. This deck looks really good. The Reno Jackson Warlock.
An Argent Squire, definitely not the card you want to draw into to go for the win. There wasn't much he could draw into, right?
Probably there's not much clear. Divine Favor is probably the best for some cards, but this kind of Paladin, I don't think it has something like Twisting Nether. So you can't really come back from this.
Yeah. Maybe equality. If there's like one equality in the deck just for these situations. But even then, what AK-Wonder did was reduce his hand down to two cards, so even a Divine Favor wouldn't have been that big.
Yes. I mean, it's really interesting when you play against those type of decks, because you can play around certain strategies, because you might be caught off guard by a card that is not usually played in the metagame. Like, in the example, the Twisting Nether, that was something RDU didn't predict at all. He was visibly surprised by the fact that he will be there will be a turn 8 Twisting Nether, and I don't blame him for playing all in, because you can't really play against one-off.
You have to play all in, right?
Yeah, you can't really play against a one-off card in your opponent deck, especially if he already played Shadow Flame, and you know that it might be just Demon Wrath or Hellfire, but those were not enough to clear those minions.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really hard to play versus toolbox decks because of that, so you just need to execute your strategy and that's it. And AK-Wonder had those cards. It's the charm of the Warlock's hero power, because you can draw so much. You can normally having only a one-off in your deck is a downside. Because the deck is unstable, but if you draw so many cards, it actually makes your deck okay.
Yeah, and for the opponents, if they try and play around everything that's in a Reno lock, then you're not going to play much. You're just not going to play any cards because there's so many different variations of what they can do. But it's going to be the lock versus Adi. He's just got his Druid left now, and this looks like, at least at the moment, fairly standard mid-range. As we spoke about earlier, Druid has received the Raven Idol. Was that yesterday? Day before?
Day before.
There's always a chance that RDU's put one in there, but it looks fairly standard so far. The Innovate with the Shredder.
Yeah,
he did have Wild Growth as well, so he has the ramp options, which is a really good start for RDU.
Oh man, I just wanted to say like his handles bad with the Wild Growth, but after picking Wild Growth, it's amazing now. He has the curve, he has everything he wants to pressure. AK-Wonder, he even has Keeper of the Grove, which is really important versus that Twilight Drake.
Yeah, and also in this matchup, the Druid versus Reno lock, what's good is that because Druid can do the combo for so much burst, you can actually just float the Warlock at sort of half health, maybe a little bit higher, and then it's like, well, if they Reno, then it's not like they're Renoing against what's on the board. They're Renoing against a combo you may or may not have in your hand, but they have to play around it, so they won't get one. A lot of the time, they don't get a Reno from 2 health, because you will just kill them from that much health anyway.
Yeah.
Don't normally leave them on. Absolutely. And the Keeper of the Grove and using the Innovate to Hero Power to clear off this Twilight Drake is really nice.
That's really good for RDU. He is pressuring with the Druids. He's dealing damage. And he has a draw as well in his hand. He has everything for now. So how can AK-Wonder actually defend himself?
Well, the Dark Bomb is a short-term solution to one of the minions on board, but it doesn't really do much afterwards.
Peddler into Finley, go.
Still, it's Peddler into Dark Bomb, I think.
Bind
He can still Dark Bomb after drawing the card from Peddler.
Oh, Mortal Coil is a really great pick here.
Yeah, Coil is nice.
It's one of the great additions to Hellfires in your hand, and he was missing that that Mortal Coil. So it's one of the best drops you can get from Dark Peddler.
Oh, and the 2-2 from the Shredder actually matches straight up against the Peddler, so that's not a bad pickup. And now the Keep of the Grove going to 2 health means Hellfire's a little bit better versus the board, but there's Thoris. And they're not getting amazing cards in terms of the reduction of the Drake and the Lotheb and the BGH, but still not bad at all on 3 cards on curve.
It will be useful later, and there is no way to deal with that Thoris right now, because you're going to have Fire Coil, but it's not enough. It's only 4 damage. So this Thoris is going to have another tick.
Just want to say that AK Wonder again has a Arena Jackson red in his hand, which changes the whole way he will play this matchup. So wouldn't be surprised if he will even bluff the fact that he has Arena Jackson with just playing Ancient Hillbot right now, Antique Hillbot right now. Because that says to his opponent, you can go all in, you can damage, you can do whatever, because I don't have Arena Jackson in my hand. I would really love to see that right now.
Yeah, you want to let them overcommit and then play the Reno to go back to full. The only scary part is AK Wonder can't deal with the Thorison. And when Thorison gets 2 procs off, it's definitely scary, because suddenly you can just Force of Nature double Savage Draw if they're the 3 cards in hand. Or the 4th is drawn into.
Yeah, all the
so, that gets like, suddenly there's a lot of damage that can happen. So you will see that the Azure Drake was one that was hit. So now there's just 3 mystery cards that are going to be a lot cheaper for the Druid.
With 2 ticks, like you can double force Savage sometimes.
Yeah.
So it changes all the math. But right now, AK Wonder just wants to survive anyway.
Some Fairy Protect is okay for a little bit later, but I think do we have to see Reno now?
This is the same situation as previous time. Like, it's exactly 16. 2 times AK Wonder used the Reno Jackson for exactly 16 health, which is, makes it like a Bran and a Killbot combo. Yeah.
With a good body.
Yeah. So, in this situation, RDU has to play Lotheb this turn, just to secure the board that there will be no Shadow Flame and no... Well, actually, there's already one Hellfire played. So does he have to play it? That's the question.
He can attack for 9. He gets another tick, and then he will have a lot of good minions on board, double spell damage, because Thorison is still the primary target. So I see no reason not to play Lotheb. On the other hand, you might want to keep Lotheb for the Twisting Nether, maybe, before turn 8. But this board is so good, like, you want to protect it. If there is a Shadow Flame, you don't want to risk a Shadow Flame.
And this is one of the ways he's going to catch up on this health that the Reno's given the Warlock. He needs to play Lotheb, lock out any sort of AoE clear shenanigans, and then look at the power on the board. He can just like demolish him next turn.
So this means that AK Wonder will be forced to play, what, like Taunts?
I think.
Well, he can go for the Antique Hillbot and...
Sunfury?
And Sunfury, but I think it's kind of too weak to the board, because the 3-3 minion will not change that much, and it will die to a Wrath, an example. And after 2 ticks, that can be just 0 mana. So I wouldn't be surprised if he goes for the Palette Shredder into Sunfear Protector, but yeah.
This is using the mana a bit better.
Yep, I mean, this is still okay. He's just doing what he can to stay as high as possible.
Ooh,
but
Savage Roar, how much damage is that?
With double
that's 10 damage from enough. Savage Roar, so you can use your hero to kill Reno Jackson, then Darnassus Aspirant kills the anti
19 through taunts.
Yeah.
So at this point, because you've seen Healbot and you've seen Reno, is there a case, because you have all these minions on board, to just play Savage Roar, the taunts, and hit him for 19?
Probably
Savage Roar is just 3 mana, 10 damage. I would say you can abuse that.
The thing is, like, as Raven mentioned before, you want to have Warlock floating on some specific number of health and then finish them with the combo. So you want to get them low enough so that you can actually OTK them instead of just using the combo now and then facing another. Well, you know there is no another Healbot, so Healbot was already used.
Yeah, and Reno's gone. I like just playing the Shredder though. RDU's not going to overcommit to the board as, you know, again, Twisting Nether's a card. So, yeah, just playing the Shredder's at least going to survive to any AoE. Does Mortal Coil into an original Mortal Coil. But again, there's just... There's just not much he can do here in terms of challenging the board. He just has to play Shredder and Earthring Farseer, I guess.
And then he's dead. with 10,
and
9,
then he dies.
15, yeah.
Yeah, does 15 damage just from the minions and 10 damage from Savagor. So it's exactly lethal right now.
All right, so it seems like Ardu is finally going to take this Reno lockdown after all those games, even getting Druid of the Claw. Just quickly count the damage to be sure.
The Druid of the Claw even makes it more powerful. So.
Yep, let's just go for the extra damage, why not?
Why not? Why not? Right? He has 10 mana, he can use everything.
All right.
It's 1-2. Ardu takes the first game for himself, and does this mean there will be a comeback?
Yeah, I mean, it's a 3-0 with Druid, right? So as long as he can draw into ramp, there's always that chance. It's just the rough moment where you don't hit any ramp in the first few turns as Druid can get really difficult. And we're not sure what the rest of AK Wonder's lineup is in terms of actual deck style. So we've seen the Reno lock do a pretty good performance so far. And now we've just got to see what the other decks are. I did see, I think that you had
Paladin.
Paladin and Warrior, isn't it?
So Paladin and Warrior, yeah, because Ardu is playing Druid. So they had Paladin, they both had Warlock, and there's a Warrior. Yeah, the Warrior can be surprising. I would really like to see the Contra Warrior with Rafam.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Like Rafam, I've not had a chance to play that card yet, but I'm quite looking forward to putting it in some good control decks for the late game. But this, I mean, not a surprise to see the Secret Paladin, to be honest. The deck is still so powerful, even after League of Explorers, which I suppose gave it Keeper of Alderman, which does some nice things for the deck, but just an extra little buff. A lot of Secret Paladins have been playing it as at least a one-off.
Yeah.
But in general, the deck's so powerful. If you curve with this deck, it's very difficult to lose.
But on the other hand, you can whiff as well, and we see AK Wonder having two Secrets in the opening hand. This is not what you want. But then Ardu has that Wild Growth, and he has Innervate as well with the coin. So Ardu having a really good start. AK Wonder, not really.
Yeah, kind of surprised a little bit that he's chose to play the Noble Sacrifice there, because although you expect your opponent to ramp, it is just going to soak up a hero power from the Druid. It's one of the secrets that are a little bit weaker versus Druid because it can proc it so easily. But also the Redemption could have been used to set up the Creeper to then respawn as a 1-1 and create even more tokens. But maybe he's playing the deck with only one Redemption and he wants to save it for a bit of a juicier target if he can set it up right before the Mysterious Challenger turn.
Yeah, that might be right. And also, maybe he's not really fond of having Redemption on the Haunted Creeper because of swipes.
That's true.
But he didn't pick up a 3-drop and he doesn't have a 4-drop still. So this looks really bad. There's a Knife Juggler. That's actually pretty good. He will be able to deal some damage, attack with the Creeper into the Druid of the Claw, deal some damage, and then still slam the Redemption.
Yeah, the only problem with Redemption is he's probably going to run the Creeper in, and then the Druid can just take out a token with Hero Power.
There's double sacrifice.
I don't think he will sacrifice it right now. I mean, unless he wants to bluff it, but this will be so weird.
Well, there is the swipe incoming on turn 4, so you always have to think about it. So you risk if there is a swipe or not. The thing with this is that you do deal 3 damage overall with the juggles, and there is the Noble Sacrifice that will deal 3 overall, because there is 1 juggle flying and then 2 damage with Noble Sacrifice.
Yeah, the thing here is it depends how he lines up his attacks, because if there was a swipe, then this is forcing the swipe onto the juggler, of course, which means the juggler is going to get redemption if he doesn't attack first. Because the problem with the attack is as well, if it spawns to get down, then it's going to throw another juggle as well. And so Keeper of the Grove on 3-2 is pretty nice, but we're going to see Redemption's hit there. So it's back to a 3-1.
It's manageable, but right now Ardu will not be able to kill the juggler because there's double sacrifice, unless he chooses not to attack.
It's a little bit rough for Ardu, actually.
Yeah, it actually
worked
out.
The sequence actually just about worked out in the way he chose to sequence them.
Well, you couldn't really play around it.
Would you not have potentially attacked with the Druid of the Claw first? Play around? That would have... Because you would still be in the same situation, right?
Yes.
If you attack first, then... Well, the juggler's still alive, except it's on 2 health. But then you just keep it anyway, right?
Yeah, that's a good point. Maybe the attack first would have been a better option. I mean, Ardu was playing into a... Avenge.
Yeah. So the Avenge then could have been silence instead of killing the juggler, I guess. But that's probably not.
Maybe
not
he thought it's a bench competitive spirit, mostly. He didn't expect redemption, noble sacrifice.
Yeah.
That Cold Hammer, though, was a really great pickup, for AK Wonder.
Yep, and now we can actually do turn 5, turn 6 instead of sort of struggling for these draws early with the Paladin. So he's got a pretty good follow up, although Ardu is building the board up. Although Ardu doesn't actually have turn 6. sorted at the moment. Oh.
Consecration.
Yeah, I think.
To deal the shade.
Value taking out the shade, right?
Yeah, yeah, it seems really good at the moment.
So you can clear the board, leave the 1-1 taunt up, and then go into Mysterious Challenger next turn.
I would favor the Loaded more. The body is just a huge thing to deal with, and if you just kind of follow up, you have a Loaded on board, you have a Mysterious Challenger, and you want to have more minions on board than just the lonely Mysterious Challenger.
The Mysterious Challenger to go on.
If the Mysterious Challenger would play next turn, I expect it will, you can just lose to a single Big Game Hunter.
Yeah,
if you will have Loaded on board, that's not possible. Because it might be, there will be still something.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. But on the other hand, it's really tasty to deal with the shade right away. And with the Lothab, he will have the turn 7 play.
This will mean that Mrs. Challenger will bring a lot of value right now. And RBU has to follow it up with Dr. Boom. There's no other way he can play it around. But at the same time, there will be a 7-7 minion on board. And he doesn't have the Big Game Hunter to deal with that. So I'm sure that AK Wonder will not care about the Dr. Boom, will just go face, straight to the face with the Mysterious Challenger, because that's how you want to win against the Druid. But he has to think about what if.
Savage
what if there will be the Savage, the, like double Savage Roar, so he has that Lothab right now to slow it down.
Yeah, he has Lothab, so that's perfect for him anyway. Just Lothab, Abuse the Surgeon, go face, and you're in the perfect spot.
You play Creeper, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You would want the Avenge on the Creeper, I guess, as the optimum target. But this is nice. Do you bother trying to kill a mini-bot just to make the trades a bit more difficult? It'll use 2 damage for face, but it's not really going to do anything to your minions. That's the positive, I suppose. If the mini-bot hits any minions, it's fine. If it hits face, you probably don't mind too much. Maybe as long as it's not for 4.
I like going for face to just deal as much damage as possible. There is a possible Ancient of Lore to heal. And you know Noble Sacrifice is not preventing Dr. Boom from attacking into one of your minions. I must move quickly. Oh, he kept the weapon. I would probably attack because of a possible True Silver, but maybe he's playing only one True Silver.
Swipe for 9 mana. Not useful right now. It will make a huge difference with the Savage Roar draw. Like, a Savage Roar into the swipe here would have been a great situation for RDU. But now let's see whether the bomb hits. Oh. And it does 3 damage to Lothab. Pushed into 10-9.
Oh, wow. Is there a way to actually deal with it?
He has to heal.
Well, no, you can Savage Roar trade, right?
You can Savage Roar, yeah.
So Savage Roar, trade the boom into 10-9, and then the boom bot into the 5-2.
That's probably the best, actually, because then you only have the spider to deal with.
Yeah, that should be okay. I think, although it doesn't feel great just Savage Roaring for 8 mana, but this is his only out here. Oh, he's just going to heal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
He's only healing and just wants to kill AK Wonder on next turn, I guess.
And there is... Wow. So that's why I would attack before, but this is 6, 7, 17 damage, so he's one off. This is so close.
And now he has to think, is there a way of... Are you killing me next turn?
Yeah.
And there's combo. So
you're
combo
against Druid,
14.
So of course there's a way for them to kill you.
Yeah. He's a 23. Combo with Ancient of Law on board deals 21. And there's still Dr. Boom on board.
You can clear Boom and Ancient of Law, right?
Yeah, you can actually attack Boom.
You can clear the board.
Can you attack with the weapon into Boom? You take 7, you're at 16, so you're off the pure combo. But then you have to kill the Boombot. Boombot can be annoying there.
I think you play around the combo if you want to win?
I think if you Abusive Sergeant, the 1-2 to kill the Dr. Boom, put the 10-9 into the 5-5, and then face tank the Boombot with the True Silver, you heal for 2, take 1 damage from the Boombot,
okay.
And fingers crossed, the Boombot hits the 2-1, or a token from the Creeper.
Because
then you still have a 10-4 on board. That he's seen that your opponent doesn't have a Big Game Hunter, but he's just going to go aggressive, so...
Well, he set up a 2-turn lethal with that, right? But...
Is he just dead to combo?
No, that's 24, actually. He's one off. So that's really good math from AK Wonder's side.
Now let's see.
Unless that's Innervate. Nope.
So now RDU has to use hero power to not to die to the attack from the True Silver Champion here. So
Swipe's
he has to use Swipe.
And then run the 5-5.
And run the 5-5 into that. And hero power and Darkness as Aspirant. That's basically it. Like, the Aspirant was a really good draw.
Yeah, because it's something that
he
can actually
put on the board.
On,
yeah.
Let's see what Ardu will do, but I don't think there's any other way out of this, because you need to armor up, otherwise you're dead to the Trusilver champion.
Yeah. And you know Trusilver champion is on board. But what are the outs for AK Wonder to win? He just needs one more damage, so
this
a second
might be rough, though, so... he's used one Consecrate. Muster won't do it over time, because the hero power will negate it if he can continue to play the 1-1s. Paladin's going to struggle to draw some burst, actually. Other than another Tyrion.
Tyrion is fine if he gets Tyrion here.
Pile Shredder is not enough, but now how much damage does Ardu have with the combo?
Well, that's 21.
21 so. Damage, so he's still one off.
Yeah, he's still one off. And you probably go for face, because you can pick up another weapon. Unless he's playing only two weapons. And he needs to count the damage here.
That's that's a tense situation for both players.
Yeah.
AK Wonder can't really lose damage here. He can't attack into the Darkness Aspirant, at least in my opinion.
It's so funny though, because RDU is like on one health essentially, and AK Wonder is 21, and they are both one damage of lethal.
That's actually true. Will Druid do Druid things? He needs an innovate for next turn. The precious innovate.
He's already used one, right?
Yes, he's
innovate out the Druid of the Claw.
He can also get a Raven's Idol get an innovate.
If that happens. Oh, Raven's Idol into Living Roots.
Oh, yeah. No.
Because he'll use one mana, won't he? Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's a good point. He needs the innovate.
Force of nature. Well,
so he can clear.
Yeah, he has to clear.
Yeah. Well,
he has to clear. Otherwise, he's just not winning this game at all. But it's all. Maybe he should use the bomb first to kill the 1-1 to see when it deals damage, but at the same time,
you can
use combo to clear the Paladin Shredder first with the bomb.
Do you really have to clear? Maybe you just yellow it and like.
You can't draw one damage.
Shapeshift at face, and then go with Force of Nature to face as well, maybe.
What do you think about the trade into the Shredder there? Would you not have killed the 1-1 instead?
Well, that allows him to always trade because
it opens up the air. Oh, that's nice.
Then 2 HP. But it still doesn't set up lethal for next turn.
Yeah, it doesn't. And now Tyrion might be really good.
Oh. That was an interesting choice. I'm not sure. Oh my goodness!
Does it again! The calls.
Oh, man. That's tough.
But
that
there's
has to
still
be
combo.
Yeah, then, obviously. But Ashbringer.
Is combo enough, though? Will he not still die? So if he combos through Tyrion, he has to use his face to kill the... Does he have to use the face to kill the 1-1? Yeah. Means he takes one damage.
AK
and he can't hero power to gain the one damage back.
The game.
Wait, what? Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah.
Wow.
That was intense. So AK Wonder twice with Reno Lock, destroying the zoo and the paladin, and eventually losing it to the RDU Druid, and now having the paladin with Tyrion secrets. A really intense match. That was really good.
Good start for AK Wonder there. I mean, like you said, that was really intense, and it's just the Reno Lock doing the work there, to be honest, because once you 2-0 up, and then you have Secret Paladin to fall back on, you always feel good, right? Like, the deck can just win out of nowhere. As long as you get an okay curve, it should be fine. But that last match, both players being one-off lethal, but
that was intense.
Madness.
Lothar, any words about that match?
Well, it was a really good match to watch and to commentate, so I'm hoping that all the matches will be looking like that. It's cool to see new decks being a consistent force. And last year standing, like the Reno Jackson, it's always fun to cast those matches because there are so many things going on, right? There's 30 different cards in a deck. Who would have thought that there would be a thing in Hearthstone, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Hearthstone is about 30 cards deck, so they'll be as consistent as possible. So you want to put 15 cards in that.
Yeah.
So you have always a consistent plan on what you will be doing with your deck. But then Reno Jackson gets printed, and you have to get 30 different cards. It's really interesting.
Could they ever do a deck, like try to incentivize a different type of deck building with another method? Like, is there another way to force you to, like, the number of beasts in your deck, right?
Yes,
the number of...
Anything can happen is kind of different as well.
Right, anything can happen does incentivize you to be, but specific types of Murlocs as well, not any Murloc.
And well, it does can mean still play. Anything can happen in a
Murloc deck. It's still Murloc okay because usually you run out of steam, but that replenishes it. So I guess.
Yeah, but Reno Jackson is the next.
Yeah, because in this Chinese style ladder, there was a deck that someone took that was pretty much half mid range, half Murlocs.
And
played
with anything.
One anything, but it played Murloc Knights. Yeah. So I'm guessing the idea is instead of trying to like one turn kill someone, you just want to say, okay, well, late game, I'm going to play 10 mana and refill my board, and then you have to deal with that again. So there's a couple of options.
I want a demon card that does that. Either way, I'm pretty happy that Reno even exists in the first place. That card is absolutely amazing. I just love
For me, the MVP of this match was Sir Finley Murgleton, just helping with the comeback with the Reno lock. I don't know if you've seen that, but basically Finley happened from Peddler. And then Eki Wonder actually chose the healing hero power, and he was able to come back versus Zoo from like free health.
Oh, that is nasty. That is amazing.
Yeah.
Especially because he played Peddler on turn two, and myself and Lothar
I caught the beginning of it.
You're picking Finley on turn two with Handlock, or with Reno Lock at the time.
And he didn't have like an early game. Yeah. So it was really weird at that point because it was very risky. He didn't have, like, the other option was to get a 2-1 minion with Tondo, which I can remember, tournament attendee, right?
Sure.
And that will allow him to clear the Haunted Creeper. So that's always something, because he had also a Zombie Chow light in the game.
Yeah.
But it was a really risky thing to pick the Finley, but it turned out to be great.
All right. So that was a great match to start Insomnia True Silver Championship, and we'll have more matches for you guys. But for now, I think we're ready to go into the break, so stay tuned for more Hearthstone after that.